I've managed to wrangle our senior media producer, Pat Cummings, into doing this GHD sit-up demo with me. Now, we've got a kind of interesting scenario here in that Pat has very little experience with this, which is good. Most people, when they get on this thing the first time, are going to have a similar lack of experience. Now, the first time you get on this thing, keep your volume low. The incredible range of motion, combined with the fact that we're handing off muscles, power, from a large muscle group, the quads, to a smaller muscle group, the abs, leads to a higher incidence of rhabdo. So, Pat, if you wake up tomorrow and you're pissing Coca-Cola, that's not a good thing. Go ahead and go to the hospital, okay? Yeah. So we're going to limit his volume here as much as we can. Now, the critical thing during a GHD sit-up, one is proper adjustment. So we want to make sure that your butt's off the end of that pad and that your knee's bent. Okay, this bent knee is going to be critical as we go through this motion. And I should mention that most of this material is covered in the CrossFit Level 1 certification curriculum. So if you want to get more in-depth into the GHD, that's a good place to do it. Now, we're going to start with a half-ROM GHD sit-up, Pat. So what you're going to do is go ahead and come all the way back to parallel. Okay, you'll notice his knees are still bent. Okay, come on back up. Good, not an easy place to hang out, right? So we're just going to move to parallel at first. You want to make sure that the machine is adjusted properly, that when the athlete's foot is back against these pads in the foot tower, that the end of his butt is off the end of the rollers. So you can unbend a little bit here. There you go. Okay. So now, Pat, what I want you to do, you're going to go down to horizontal. And when you turn around, okay, you're going to simultaneously sit up and fire your knees straight, and not kind of straight, like you need to lock them down. What this is going to do is it's going to fire his quads, and it's going to add velocity coming up over the top. We'll do the movement, and then we'll kind of explain why that's important. So go ahead and give it a shot. Fire! Okay, so we're getting the knees coming, and then the chest coming. I'm getting a little bit of a kind of a wave effect. It's pop, pop. What I want is start sitting up, start straightening the knees, and when you start to feel that mechanical advantage, slam them both at the same time. Good. And you see that huge increase in velocity. Do it again. Pop. One more time. Pop as hard as you can, both at the same time. Good. Okay. That one, last one was actually a little off, and you probably felt it. But the two right before that you got, and you felt that velocity coming over. So it's almost as simultaneous. He's back at parallel, and then that hip starts to close, and then he starts to straighten. And as he feels the power curve amp up, and you do, right? As you start to come off horizontal, you feel more powerful. You feel like you're in a better position. That's going to be your cue to, boom, fire both those things at once, okay? Here's why. I need this bent knee. If Pat's legs are straight, and he goes back and comes back up, and I don't actually want you to do this. The quad's not going to contribute any velocity to the motion at all. What it's all going to be is actually the psoas, which is a very small muscle group pulling on Pat's spine to bring him over. The psoas basically connects the lumbar spine to the pelvis, and that's what pulls you up over the top. Now, if your legs are bent, and the spine and pelvis are one piece because you're staying tight in your midsection, when that straightens, what's going to flex that pelvis, going to cause flexion at the hip, is going to be that quad. Now, if your legs are straight, that quad can't do that. And the quad can't do it because there's no angle, right? So that knee firing down hard hits that hip flexor and pulls him over with no shear. Okay, and we were actually working on this before we started rolling the camera, and you felt that, right? He got back, and he wasn't firing his knee down. You felt that impact on the lower back, okay? So first we're going to start, when we're learning this movement, with that half ROM. Go ahead and do two more for me. Try and get your timing down. Good. Little more in the chest. Get the chest up. There you go. Get the chest up and fire. Chest up, fire. Good. Okay. Once we have the athlete able to establish velocity there and he's comfortable being in this machine, we're going to go ahead and add some ROM. So I don't want to quite go all the way yet. Let's say 3/4. Just go past parallel for me. Good. Up and fire. Good. Up and fire. And you'll see you kind of miscued that one. But when he comes up, what we're going to see is this move. And Pat, let me jump on there. I want to give you a little bit of demo about the velocity that we're looking for. And I'm seeing a little bit of hesitancy in you coming up and firing hard. You can actually use the chest, use that momentum to really flex forward. So again, you see that that knee's bent. And what I'm gonna do is when I come up, I'm gonna pull back with my feet. Okay, so they're actually pulling back into this position. Boom! And I'm firing. And I should actually be able to move this machine. I'm hitting that plate so hard, I should be able to have a GHD race. Okay, so let's try that again. Fire into it. Okay, so what's happening is you're getting this straightening and then we're getting the shear. Are you feeling that in your lower back? You must be. Yeah. Okay, so what Pat's doing is he's firing his knee down and then he's kind of sitting up. It's not all happening in concert. So come on back just a little bit. Just come into my arm. So we just want you to feel this. It's going pop. See, do you feel that asynchronicity? Here, there it is. Here, good.
Yeah.
Okay. So you feel that we want them both to come at the same time, and when they don't, that sucks, doesn't it? It hurts. So instead of having him go all the way down, because the timing's off, we're not going to fall into parallel, pass parallel all the way down. A coaching mistake there. We went too far too fast. I just want you to come 15 degrees off vertical and see if we can get those both going at the same time.
Just stay about here?
Yep. Pop. You're firing here, and we got a disconnect. Okay? It all comes together. One piece. That's it. Here. Boom. Good. Boom. Good. Okay, take it a little further. That was a little early. Pop. Good. And now you start to feel that power. And you can probably see it at home, and you can definitely hear it here, your foot hitting that pad. That kind of, that coming together, everything moving at the same time, wham, wham, is what's going to keep this move safe. Okay, so let's just go down to parallel. You understand that once you have that timing down, when you know when to fire that knee, it all becomes the same, okay? So we're gonna go back 15 degrees and I want you to just keep working into it. We're gonna get back to parallel and then we're gonna give you a break. I don't want you to accumulate too much volume here, okay? So pop and back, pop, a little early, pop. Okay, you're bending that knee early, bring it all together. Okay, come back up, okay? So we're still having that asynchronicity happen. Let's literally do 5 degrees, okay? So I just want you to come back, hit my hand, pop. Back a little further, pop. Pop. Initiate with the chest, not the knees. There, initiate with the chest, not the knees. Good. So we're starting to get some velocity there. I think what you were doing is you're trying to fire the knee to initiate that movement. Yeah. And actually, the torso needs to be moving in some degree for that to help.
Okay.
Okay? You follow that?
Yeah.
Let's try again. Good. Get the torso moving. Good. Okay, relax.
Yeah.
You got it?
Yeah.
I think you do. And you see that what it took me a minute there to identify, but it was that you were firing that knee and then you were trying to initiate the torso. There's so much space in here. I think what was happening is that if you're not totally tight here, there's no way power is going to get from here to here. We need to have it happen the other way so we get that torso moving and then that firing down there. Okay. All right, so I'm going to take this foot through full ROM, and you're going to notice the chest initiates the movements and the knees finish it. So you see that happening? Right, that chest comes up. Now we're going to play a game. This is going to be kind of interesting. Basically, you generate a ton of velocity with this. So it's fun to get a partner and just kind of, you know, try and bury them. So I'm going to try and bury you, Pat, in my garden right here. So we're going to play a little game of catch. Okay? And basically, I'll start with the ball. I'm going to catch it, which causes some stabilization. I'm going to bring it up over my head, which is going to cause even more torque on my hip and my abs. But as I come back and around, basically, I'm going to use the kip coming over the top and that velocity of the knee firing straight to throw this at you. Tough. Okay. Basically, what's happening is when we add an external load to this, when I put this load in my hands and I go way back, the tendency for revolution, for twisting at the hip, gets tremendous. And so fighting that is really hard. So what I'm doing that entire time is trying to move this thing, and of course it's not to my advantage to do so. If I wanted to move it faster, I'd throw it from here instead of over my head. So let's just illustrate the principle. Go ahead, back up. By keeping it here, I'm gonna actually reduce the torque. And I'm gonna be able to kind of get that chest pass in there. You feel the difference in velocity, okay? Was it harder the second time from the chest? Yeah. And this is fun. Now, imagine that we had two GHDs, we could put them end to end and do this. Of course, eventually you see that GHD move. With enough velocity with this movement done right, it always moves. And so they'd eventually end up impacting each other. A bunch of fun things you can do with this. Actually, you want to go grab a 45-pound bar out of the gym. What we're going to do is now a prone hold. So in addition to working that hip flexion and that trunk flexion, we can work those isometrically, statically. This is kind of like an L-sit in that you're developing midline stability, the ability to flex the abs and to keep that all tight. But you're doing so in a non-moving environment, in an isometric contraction. So this sucks, okay? We're just gonna do a bench press. Now, if you want a 45-pound bench press to make you feel like a little girl, this is how to do it, okay? I'm basically going to come back into a static hold. And just press. You wanna try it? Basically what's happening is we're taking a load, we're putting it out beyond the point of rotation. My skeleton's not there to hold it up anymore, not like an overhead press is. So it's all on the skeletal muscles, really, of the abs and the obliques to hold you up while you do this. Okay, so you'll notice what I'm doing is I'm laying it on my thigh and rolling back. Rolling back is probably the hardest part. Okay, so go ahead and take this. Pat's gonna be my human rack here. And I'll do the same thing for you, brother. So. Wouldn't jump up there. And again, because I'm a little leery of Pat getting a ton of volume here, we're just going to do this once.
Okay. So I'm locked.
Keep your knees bent.
Keep them bent. Okay.
Yeah. They don't need to be tremendously bent, but a little bit. So he's back down past horizontal, chest up, push. Tight hands. Tight hands. Stay tight. Sit up a little bit more. Sit up a little bit more. Last one. Back down on your chest and roll up. How'd that feel?
Oh, yeah.
So what it really is doing is illustrating a principle. When you're standing on your own two feet, your midline's stabilized by your skeleton. But when you're horizontal, levitating, your midline, meaning your shoulder and hip staying in line, isn't helped by your skeleton, not an inch. So we add just this tiny little load to that, and it's impossible. Now, of course, you could just do this prone. You could just lay back without that external load and it'd still be tough. Okay, go ahead, jump off. So what are we trying to take away from the GHD? I want you to take away that the GHD sit-up is a ton of velocity, a ton of power, and it's being handed off from the quads to the abs. That large muscle group to small muscle group handoff means that we keep volume limited when we're learning to do this. To avoid shear on the lower spine, we've got to fire that knee straight. We can do a bunch of fun things with the GHD setup. You can come up to parallel, you can do full ROM, we can throw from that, and we can do prone positions. And the whole idea of that whole thing is that we're building the ability to stabilize the midline, to keep the core tight under load. Thanks, Pat.